Chapter 25, An Old Friend. The herbalist's shop had a cherry sign and was easy to find. A short, curly-haired woman sat by the door. She was holding a frog in one hand and writing with the other. Eragon assumed that she was Angela, the herbalist. On either side of the store was a house. "Which one do you think is his?" he asked. Brom deliberated, then said, "Let's find out." He approached the woman and asked politely, "Could you tell us which house Jo lives in?"
"I could," she continued writing.
"Will you tell us?"
"Yes."
She fell silent, but her pen scribbled faster than ever. The frog on her hand croaked and looked at them with baleful eyes. Brom and Eragon waited uncomfortably, but she said no more. Eragon was about to blurt out something when Angela looked up.
"Of course, I'll tell you, and all you have to do is ask. Your first question was whether or not I could tell you. The second was if I would tell you, but you never actually put the question to me."
"Then let me ask properly," said Brom with a smile. "Which house is Jayode's, and why are you holding a frog?"
"Now we're getting somewhere," she bantered. "Jayode is on the right, and as for the frog, he's actually a toad. I'm trying to prove that toads don't exist, that there are only frogs."
"How can toads not exist if you have one on your hand right now?" interrupted Eragon. "Besides, what good will it do, proving that there are only frogs?" The woman shook her head vigorously, dark curls bouncing.
"No, no, no, you don't understand. If I prove toads don't exist, then this is a frog and was never a toad. Therefore, the toad you see now doesn't exist, and," she raised a small finger, "if I can prove there are only frogs, then toads won't be able to do anything bad like make teeth fall out, cause warts, and poison or kill people. Also, witches won't be able to use any of their evil spells because, of course, there won't be any toads around."
"I see," said Brom delicately. "It sounds interesting, and I would like to hear more, but we have to meet Jayode."
"Of course," she said, waving her hand and returning to her writing.
Once they were out of the herbalist's earring, Eragon said, "She's crazy."
"It's possible," said Brom, "but you never know. She might discover something useful, so don't criticize. Who knows, toads might really be frogs."
"And my shoes are made of gold," retorted Eragon. They stopped before a door with a wrought iron knocker and marble doorstep. Brom banged 3 times. No one answered. Eragon felt slightly foolish. "Maybe this is the wrong house. Let's try the other one," he said. Brom ignored him and he knocked again, pounding loudly. Again, no one answered. Eragon turned away in exasperation, then heard someone run to the door. A young woman with a pale complexion and light blonde hair cracked it open. Her eyes were perfectly puffy. It looked like she had been crying, but her voice was perfectly steady.
"Yes, what do you want?"
"Does Jo live here?"
asked Brom kindly. The woman dipped her head a little.
"Yes, he is my husband. Is he expecting you?"
She opened the door no further.
"No, but we need to talk to him," said Brom.
"He's very busy."
"We have traveled far. It's very important that we see him." Her face hardened.
"He is busy."
Brom bristled, but his voice stayed pleasant.
"Since he is unavailable, would you please give him a message?"
Her mouth twitched, but she consented.
"Tell him that a friend from Gilead is waiting outside."
The woman seemed suspicious, but said,
"Very well."
She closed the door abruptly. Eragon heard footsteps recede.
"That wasn't very polite," he commented. "Keep your opinions to yourself," snapped Brom. "And don't say anything. Let me do the talking."
He crossed his arms and tapped his fingers. Eragon clamped his mouth shut and looked away. The door suddenly flew open, and a tall man burst out of the house. His expensive clothes were rumpled, his gray hair wispy, and he had a mournful face with short eyebrows. A long scar stretched across his scalp to his temple. At the sight of them, his eyes grew wide, and he sagged against the doorframe, speechless. His mouth opened and closed several times like a gasping fish. He asked softly in an incredulous voice,
"Brom?"
Brom put a finger to his lips and reached forward, clasping the man's arms.
"It's good to see you, Jayode. I'm glad that memory has not failed you. But do not use that name. It would be unfortunate if anyone knew I was here."
Jayode looked around wildly, shock plain on his face.
"I thought you were dead," he whispered. "What happened? Why haven't you contacted me before?" "All things will be explained. Do you have a place where we can talk safely?"
Jayode hesitated, swinging his gaze between Eragon and Brom, face unreadable. Finally, he said,
"We can't talk here. But if you wait a moment, I'll take you somewhere we can."
"Fine," said Brom. Jayode nodded and vanished behind the door. "I hope I can learn something of Brom's past," thought Eragon. There was a rapier at Jayode's side when he reappeared. An embroidered jacket hung loosely on his shoulder. matched by a plumed hat. Brom cast a critical eye at that finery, and Jeod shrugged self-consciously. He took them through Tirum toward the citadel. Eragon led the horses behind the two men. Jeod gestured at their destination.
Ristot, the Lord of Tirum, has decreed that all businesses' owners must have their headquarters in his castle, even though most of us conduct our business elsewhere. We still have to rent room there. It's nonsense, but we abide by it anyway to keep him calm. We'll be free of eavesdroppers in there. The walls are thick.
They went through the fortress's main gate and into the keep. Jeod strode to a side door and pointed to an iron ring.
You can tie the horses there. No one will bother them.
When Snowfire and Kadok were safely tethered, he opened the door with an iron key and let them inside. Within was a long, empty hallway lit by torches set into the walls. Eragon was surprised by how cold and damp it was. When he touched the wall, his fingers slid over a layer of slime. He shivered. Jeod snatched a torch from its bracket and led them down the hall. They stopped before a heavy wooden door. He unlocked it and ushered them into a room dominated by a bearskin rug laden with stuffed chairs. Bookshelves stacked with leather-bound tomes covered the walls. Jeod piled wood into the fireplace, then thrust the torch under it. The fire quickly roared.
You old man, you have some explaining to do.
Brom's face crinkled with a smile.
Who are you calling old man? The last time I saw you, there was no gray in your hair. Now it looks like the final stages of decomposition.
And you look the same as you did nearly 20 years ago. Time seems to have preserved you as a crotchety old man, just to inflict wisdom upon each new generation. Enough of this. Get on with the story. That's always what you were good at, said Jeod impatiently.
Aragorn's ears pricked and he waited eagerly to hear what Brom would say. Brom relaxed into his chair and pulled out his pipe. He slowly blew a smoke ring that turned green, darted into the fireplace, then flew up the chimney.
Do you remember what we were doing in Gilead?
Yes, of course, said Jeod. That sort of thing is hard to forget.
An understatement, but true nevertheless, said Brom dryly. When we were separated, I couldn't find you. In the midst of the turmoil, I stumbled into a small room. There wasn't anything extraordinary in it, just crates and boxes. But out of curiosity, I rummaged around. Fortune smiled on me that hour, for I found what we had been searching for. An expression of shock ran over Jeod's face. Once it was in my hands, I couldn't wait for you. At any second, I might have been discovered, and all lost. Disguising myself as best as I could, I fled the city and ran to the...
Brom hesitated and glanced at Eragon, then said,
Ran to our friends. They stored it in a vault for safekeeping and made me promise to care for whomever received it. Until the day when my skills would be needed, I had to disappear. No one could know that I was alive, not even you, though it grieved me to pain you unnecessarily. So I went north and hid in Carvajal.
Eragon clenched his jaw, infuriating that Brom was deliberately keeping him in the dark. Jeod frowned and asked,
Then our friends knew that you were alive all along?
Yes,
he sighed.
I suppose the ruse was unavoidable, though I wish they had told me. Isn't Carvajal farther north than the other side of the spine?
Brom inclined his head. For the first time, Jeod inspected Eragon. His gray eyes took in every detail. He raised his eyebrows and said,
I assume then that you are fulfilling your duty.
Brom shook his head.
No, it's not that simple. It was stolen a while ago. At least, that's what I presume. For I haven't received word from our friends, and I suspect their message were waylaid. So I decided to find out what I could do. Eragon happened to be traveling in the same direction. We have stayed together for a time now.
Jeod looked puzzled. But if you haven't sent any messages, how could you know that it was...
Brom overrode him quickly, saying,
Aragorn's uncle was brutally killed by Razak. They burned down his home and nearly caught him in the process. He deserves revenge. But they have left us without a trail to follow, and we need help finding them.
Jeod's face cleared.
I see. But why have you come here? I don't know where the Razak might be hiding, and anyone who does won't tell you.
Standing, Brom reached into his robe and pulled out the Razak's flask. He tossed it to Jeod.
There's Seether oil in there. The dangerous kind. The Razak were carrying it. They lost it by the trail, and we happened to find it. We need to see Tirim's shipping records so that we can trace the Empire's purchases of the oil. That should tell us where the Razak lair is.
Lines appeared on Jeod's face as he thought. He pointed at the books on the shelves.
Do you see those? They are all the records from my business. One business. You have gotten yourself into a project that could take months. There is another, greater problem. The records you seek are held in this castle, but only Brand, Ristart's Administrator of Trade, sees them on a regular basis.
Traders, such as myself, aren't allowed to handle them. They fear that we will falsify the results, thus cheating the Empire of its precious taxes. I can deal with that when the time comes, said Brom. But we need a few days of rest before we can think about proceeding. Jayod smiled.
It seems that is my turn to help you. My house is yours, of course. Do you have any other name while you are here?
Yes, said Brom. I'm Neil, and the boy is Evan.
Eragon, said Jayod thoughtfully. You have a unique name. Few have ever been named after the first rider. In my life, I've read about only 3 people who were called such.
Eragon was startled that Jayod knew the origin of his name.
Brom looked at Eragon. Could you go check on the horses, make sure they're all right? I don't think I tied Snowfire to the ring tightly enough.
They're trying to hide something from me. The moment I leave, they're going to talk about it. Eragon shoved himself out of the chair and left the room, slamming the door shut. Snowfire had not moved. The knot that held him was fine. Scratching the horse's necks, Eragon leaned sullenly against the castle wall. It's not fair, he complained to himself. If only I could hear what they were saying. He jolted upright, electrified. Brom had once taught him some words that could enhance his hearing. Keen ears aren't exactly what I want, but I should be able to make it work. But I should be able to make the words work. After all, look, what I could do with Brisinger. He concentrated intensely and searched for his power. Once it was in his grasp, he said,
Dver stenor un atra eka orna,
and imbued the words with his will. As the power rushed out of him, he heard a faint whisper in his ears, but nothing more. Disappointed, he sank back, then Jayod said,
And I've been doing that for almost 8 years now.
Eragon looked around. No one was there except for a few guards standing against the far wall of the keep. Grinning, he sat in the courtyard and closed his eyes.
I never expected you to become a merchant, said Brom. After all the time you spent in books and finding the passageway in that manner, what made you take up trading instead of remaining a scholar?
After Gilead, I didn't have much taste for sitting in musty rooms and reading scrolls. I decided to help Ajihad as best as I could, but I'm no warrior. My father was a merchant as well. You may remember that.
He helped me get started. However, the bulk of my business is nothing more than a front to get goods into Cirta. But I take it things have been going badly, said Brom.
Yes.
None of my shipments have gotten through lately, and Trojanheim is running low on supplies. Somehow, the Empire, at least I think it's them, has discovered those of us who have been helping support Trojanheim. But I'm still not convinced that it's the Empire. No one sees any soldiers. I don't understand it. Perhaps Galbatorix himself hired mercenaries to harass.
I heard you lost a ship recently.
The last one I owned, answered Jayod bitterly. Every man on it was loyal and brave. I doubt I'll ever see them again. The only option I have left is to send caravans into Cirta or Gilead, which I know won't get there, no matter how many guards I hire, or charter someone else's ship to carry the goods. But no one will take them now.
How many merchants have been helping you? Asked Brom.
Oh, a good number, up and down the seaboard. All of them have been plagued by the same troubles.
I know what you might be thinking. I've pondered it many night myself, but I cannot bear the thought of a traitor with that much knowledge and power. If there is one, we're all in jeopardy. You should return to Trojanheim.
And take Eragon there? Interrupted Brom.
They'd tear him apart. It's the worst place he could be right now. Maybe in a few months, or even better, a year? Can you imagine how the dwarves will react? Everyone will be trying to influence him, especially Islan Zadi. He and Saphira won't be safe in Trojanheim. Until I at least get them through Tuatha Dû Uruthim.
Dwarves, thought Eragon excitedly. Where is this Trojanheim? And why did he tell Jayod about Saphira? He shouldn't have done that without asking me.
Still, I have a feeling that they are in need of your power and wisdom.
Wisdom, snorted Brom.
I'm just what you said earlier, a crotchety old man.
Many would disagree.
Let them. I've no need to explain myself. No, Ajihad will have to get along without me. What I'm doing now is much more important. But the prospect of a traitor raises troubling questions. I wonder if that's how the Empire knew where to be.
His voice trailed off.
And I wonder why. I haven't been contacted about this, said Jayod.
Maybe they tried, but if there's a traitor, Brom paused. I will have to send word to Ajihad. Do you have a messenger you can trust?
I think so, said Jayod.
It depends on where we would have to go. I don't know, said Brom. I've been isolated so long, my contacts have probably died or forgotten me. Could you send him to whoever receives your shipments?
Yes, but it'll be risky.
What isn't these days? How soon can he leave?
He can go in the morning. I'll send him to Gilead. It'll be faster, said Jayod.
What can he take to convince Ajihad the message comes from you?
Here, give your man my ring, and tell him that if he loses it, I'll personally tear his liver out. It was given to me by the queen.
Aren't you cheery? Commented Jayod.
Brom grunted after a long silence. He said,
We'd better go out and join Eragon. I get worried when he's alone. That boy has an unnatural propensity for being wherever there's trouble.
Are you surprised?
Not really.
Eragon heard the chairs being pushed back. He quickly pulled his mind away and opened his eyes. What's going on? He muttered to himself. Jude and the other traitors are in trouble for helping people the Empire doesn't favor. Brom found something in Gilead and went to Harvard Hall to hide? What would be so important that he wouldn't let his own friend think he was dead for nearly 20 years? He mentioned a queen, when there aren't any queens in the known kingdom, and dwarves, who, as he himself told me, disappeared underground long ago. He wanted answers, but he would not confront Bronn now and risk jeopardizing their mission. No, he would wait until they left Tirum, and then he would persist until the old man explained his secrets. Aragorn's thoughts were whirling that the door opened.
Were the horses all right? Asked Bronn.
Fine, said Aragorn. They untied the horses and left the castle. As they re-entered the main body of Tirum, Brom said,
So, Jaod, you finally got married, and, he winked slyly, to a lovely young woman. Congratulations.
Jaod did not seem happy with the compliment. He hunched his shoulders and stared down the street.
Whether congratulations are in order is debatable right now. Helen isn't very happy.
Why? What does she want? Asked Brom.
The usual, said Jaod with a resigning shrug. A good home, happy children, food on the table, and pleasant company. The problem is that she comes from a wealthy family. Her father has invested heavily in my business. If I keep suffering these losses, there won't be enough money for her to live the way she's used to, Jaod continued. But please, my troubles are not your troubles. A host should never bother his guests with his own concerns. While you are in my house, I will let nothing more than an overfull stomach disturb you.
Thank you, said Brom. We appreciate the hospitality. Our travels have been long without comforts of any kinds. Do you happen to know where we could find an inexpensive shop? All this riding has worn out our clothes.
Of course. That's my job, said Jaod, lightening up.
He talked eagerly about prices and stores until his house was in sight. Then he asked, Would you mind if we went somewhere else to eat? It might be awkward if you came in right now.
Whatever makes you feel comfortable, said Brom.
Jaod looked relieved.
Thanks.
Let's leave your horse in my stable.
They did as he suggested and then followed him to a large tavern unlike the Green Chestnut. This one was loud, clean, and full of boisterous people. When the main course arrived, a stuffed suckling pig, Eragon dug into the meat, but he especially savored the potatoes, carrots, and turnips, and sweet apples that accompanied it. It had been a long time since he had eaten much more than wild game. They lingered over the meal for hours. As Brom and Jaod swapped stories, Eragon did not mind. He was warm, a lively tune jangled in the background, and there was more than enough food. The spirited tavern fell pleasantly on his ear. When they finally exited the tavern, the sun was nearly on the horizon.
You two go ahead. I have to check on something, Eragon said. He wanted to see Saphira and make sure that she was safely hidden.
Brom agreed absently.
Be careful. Don't take too long.
Wait, said Jaod.
Are you going outside, Tirum?
Eragon hesitated, then reluctantly nodded.
Make sure you're inside the walls before dark. The gates close and then the guards won't let you back in until morning.
I won't be late, promised Eragon. He turned around and loped down the street toward Tirum's outer wall. Once out of the city, he breathed deeply, enjoying the fresh air.
Saphira, he called. Where are you?
She guided him off the road and to the base of a mossy cliff surrounded by maples. He saw her head poking out of the trees on the top of and waved.
How am I supposed to get up there?
If you find a clearing, I'll come down and get you.
No,
he said, eyeing the cliff.
That won't be necessary. I'll just climb up.
It's too dangerous.
And you worry too much. Let me have some fun. Eragon pulled off his gloves and started climbing. He relished the physical challenge. There were plenty of handholds, so the ascent was easy. He was soon high above the trees. Halfway up, he stopped on a ledge to catch his breath. Once his strength returned, he stretched up for the next handhold, but his arms were not long enough. Stymied, he searched for another crevice or ridge to grasp. There was none. He tried backing down, but his legs could not reach the last foothold. Saphira watched with unblinking eyes. He gave up and said, I could use some help.
This is your own fault.
Yes, I know. Are you going to help me get down or not?
If I weren't around, you would be in a very bad situation.
Aragorn's eyes rolled. You don't have to tell me.
You're right. After all, how can a mere dragon expect to tell a man like yourself what to do? In fact, everyone should stand in awe of your brilliance of finding the only dead end. Why, if you had started only a few feet in either direction, the path to the top would have been clear.
She cocked her head at him, eyes bright. All right, I made a mistake. Now can you please get me out of here? He pleaded. She pulled her head from the edge of the cliff. After a moment, he called, Saphira! Above him, there were only swaying trees. Saphira, come back! He roared. With a loud crash, Saphira barreled off the top of the cliff, flipping around midair. She floated down to Eragon like a huge bat and grabbed his shirt with her claws, scratching his back. He then let go of the rocks and she yanked him up in the air. After a brief flight, she set him down gently on the top of a cliff and tugged her claws out of his shirt.
Foolishness,
said Saphira gently. Eragon looked away, studying the landscape. The cliff provided a wonderful view of their surroundings, especially the foaming sea, as well as protection against unwelcome eyes. Only birds would see Saphira here. It was an ideal location.
Is Brom's friend trustworthy?
She asked. I don't know. Eragon proceeded to recount the day's events. There are forces circling us that we aren't aware of. Sometimes I wonder if we can ever understand the true motives of the people around us. They all seem to have secrets.
It is the way of the world. Ignore all the schemes and trust in the nature of each problem. Brom is good. He means us no harm. We don't have to fear his plans.
I hope so, he said, looking down at his hands.
This finding of the Razaks through writing is a strange way of tracking, she remarked. Would there be a way to use magic to see the records without being inside the room?
I'm not sure. You would have to combine the words for seeing with distance, or maybe light and distance. Either way, it seems rather difficult. I'll ask Brom.
That would be wise.
They lapped into tranquil silence. You know, we may have to stay here a while. Saphira's answer held a hard edge.
And, as always, I will be left to wait outside.
That's not how I want it. Soon enough, we will travel together again.
May that day come quickly.
Eragon smiled and hugged her. He noticed then how rapidly the light was fading. I have to go now, before I'm locked out of Tirim. Hunt tomorrow, and I will see you in the evening. She spread her wings.
Come, I will take you down.
He got onto her scaly back and held on tightly as she launched off the cliff, gliding over the trees, then landed on a knoll. Eragon thanked her and ran back to Tirim. He came into sight of the portcullises just as they were beginning to lower. Calling for them to wait, he put a burst of speed and slipped inside seconds before the gateway slammed closed.
You cut that a little close, observed one of the guards. It won't happen again, assured Eragon, bending over to catch his breath.
He wound his way through the darkened city to Jayod's house. A lantern hung outside like a beacon. A plump butler answered his knock and ushered him inside without a word. Tapestries covered the stone walls. Elaborate rugs dotted the polished wood floor, which glowed with the light from three candelabra hanging from the ceiling. Smoke drifted through the air and collected above.
This way, sir. Your friend is in the study.
They passed scores of doorways until the butler opened one to reveal a study. Books covered the room's wall, unlike those in Jayod's office. These come in every shape and size. A fireplace filled with blazing logs warmed the room. Brom and Jayod sat before an oval writing desk, talking amiably. Brom raised his pipe and said in a jovial voice,
Ah, here you are. We were getting worried about you. How was your walk?
I wonder what put him in such a good mood. Why doesn't he just come out and ask how Saphira is? Pleasant, but the guards almost locked me outside the city, and Tirim is big. I had trouble finding this house. Jayod chuckled.
When you have seen Drasleona, Gilead, or even Kuasta, you won't be so easily impressed by this small ocean city. I like it here, though. When it's not raining, Tirim is really quite beautiful.
Eragon turned to Brom. Do you have any idea how long we'll be here? Brom spread his palms upward.
That's hard to tell. It depends on whether we can get the records and how long it will take us to find what we need. We'll all have to help. It'll be a huge job. I'll talk with Brand tomorrow and see if he'll let us examine the records.
I don't think I'll be able to help, Eragon said, shifting uneasily.
Why not? Asked Brom. There will be plenty of work for you.
Eragon lowered his head. I can't read. Brom straightened with disbelief.
You mean Garrow never taught you?
He knew how to read? Asked Eragon, puzzled. Jayod watched them with interest.
Of course he did, snorted Brom. The proud fool. What was he thinking? I should have realized he wouldn't have taught you. He probably considered it an unnecessary luxury.
Brom scowled and pulled at his beard angrily.
This sets my plans back, but not irreparably. I'll just have to teach you how to read. It won't take long if you put your mind to it.
Eragon winced. Brom's lessons were usually intense and brutally direct.
How much more can I learn at one time? I suppose it's necessary, he said ruefully.
You'll enjoy it. There is much you can learn from books and scrolls, said Jayod. He gestured at the wall. These books are my friends, my companions. They make me laugh and cry and find meaning in life.
It sounds intriguing, admitted Eragon.
Always the scholar, aren't you? Asked Brom.
Jayod shrugged.
Not anymore. I'm afraid I've degenerated into a bibliophile.
A what? Asked Eragon.
One who loves books, explained Jayod and resumed conversing with Brom.
Bored, Eragon scanned the shelves. An elegant book set with gold studs caught his attention. He pulled it off the shelf and stared at it curiously. It was bound in black leather, carved with mysterious runes. Eragon ran his fingers over the cover and savored its cool smoothness. The letters inside were printed with a reddish, glossy ink. He let the pages slip past his fingers. A column of script set off from the regular lettering caught his eye. The words were long and flowing, full of graceful lines and sharp points. Eragon took the book to Brom.
What is this? he asked, pointing to the strange writing. Brom looked at the page closely and raised his eyebrows in surprise.
Jailed, you've expanded your collection. Where did you get this? I haven't seen one in ages.
Jailed strained his neck to see the book.
Ah, yes, the Domia Aber Werda.
A man came through a few years ago and tried to sell it to a trader down by the wharves. Fortunately, I happened to be there and was able to save the book, along with his neck. He didn't have a clue what it was. It's odd, Eragon, that you should pick up this book. The Dominance of Fate, said Brom. Of all the items in this house, it's probably worth the most. It details a complete history of Alagasia, starting long before the elves landed here, and ending a few decades ago. The book is very rare, and is the best of its kind. When it was written, the Empire decried it as blasphemy and burned the author, Hesland the Monk. I didn't think any copies still existed. The lettering you asked about is from the ancient language.
What does it say? Said Eragon. It took Brom a moment to read the writing.
It's part of an album poem that tells you the years they fought the dragons. This excerpt describes one of the kings, Serenthor, as he rides into battle. The elves love this poem and tell it regularly, though you need 3 days to do it properly, so that they won't repeat the mistakes of the past. At times, they sing it so beautifully, it seems the very rocks will cry.
Eragon returned to his chair, holding the book gently.
It's amazing that a man who is dead can talk to people through these pages. As long as this book survives, his ideas live. I wonder if it contains any information about the Razak.
He browsed through the book while Brom and Jaod spoke. Hours passed and Eragon began to drowse. Out of pity of his exhaustion, Jaod bid them a good night.
The butler will show you to your rooms.
On the way upstairs, the servant said,
If you need any assistance, use the bell pull next to the bed.
He stopped before a cluster of 3 doors, bowed, then backed away. As Brom entered the room on the right, Eragon asked,
Can I talk to you?
You just did, but come in anyway.
Eragon closed the door behind himself.
Saphir and I had an idea.
Is there? Brom stopped him with a raised hand and pulled the curtains shut over the window.
When you talk of such things, you would do well to make sure no unwelcome ears are present.
Sorry, said Eragon, braiding himself for the slip. Anyway, is it possible to conjure an image of something that you can't see?
Brom sat on the edge of his bed.
What you are talking about is called scrying. It is quite possible and extremely helpful in some situations, but it has a major drawback. You can only observe people, places, and things you've already seen. If you were to scry the Razak, you would see them all right, but not their surroundings. There are other problems as well. Let's say you wanted to view a page in a book, one that you had already seen. You could only see the page if the books were open to it. If the book were closed when you tried this, the page would appear completely black.
Why can't you view objects that you haven't seen? Asked Eragon. Even with those limitations, he realized scrying could be very useful.
I wonder if I could view something leagues away and use magic to affect what was happening there.
Because, Brom said patiently, to scry you have to know what you're looking at and where to direct your power. Even if a stranger was described to you, it would still be nigh impossible to view him, not to mention the ground and whatever else might be surrounding him. You have to know what you're going to scry before you can scry it. Does that answer your question?
Eragon thought for a moment. But how is it done? Do you conjure up the image in thin air?
Not usually, said Brom, shaking his white head. That takes more energy than projecting it onto a reflective surface like a pool of water or a mirror. Some riders used to travel everywhere they could, trying to see as much as possible. Then, whenever war or some other calamity occurred, they would be able to view the events through Alagasia.
May I try it? Asked Eragon.
Brom looked at him carefully. No, not now. You're tired, and scrying takes a lot of strength. I will tell you the words, but you must promise not to attempt it tonight. And I'd rather wait until we leave Tirum. I have more to teach you.
Eragon smiled. I promise.
Very well. Brom bent over and quietly whispered,
Dramur Kopa,
into Aragon's ears. Eragon took a moment to memorize the words. Maybe after we've left Tirum, I can scry Rorin. I would like to see how he's doing. I'm afraid the Razak might go after him.
I don't mean to frighten you, but that's a distinct possibility, said Brom. Although Rorin was gone most of the time the Razak were in Carvajal. I'm sure they asked questions about him. Who knows? They may have met him while you were in Therensfold. Either way, I doubt their curiosity is sated. You're on the loose, after all, and the king is probably threatening them with terrible punishment if you aren't found. If they get frustrated enough, they'll go back and interrogate Rorin. It is only a matter of time.
If that's true, the only way to keep Rorin safe is to let the Razak know where I am, so they'll have to come after me instead of him.
No, that won't work either. You're not thinking, admonished Brom. If you can't understand your enemies, how can you expect to anticipate them? Even if you exposed your location, the Razak would still chase Rorin. Do you know why?
Eragon straightened and tried to consider every possibility.
Well, if I stay in hiding long enough,
They might get frustrated and capture Roran to force me to reveal myself. If that didn't work, they'd just kill him to hurt me. Also, if I become a public enemy of the Empire, they might use him as bait to catch me. And if I met Roran and they found out about it, they would torture him to find out where I was.
Very good. You figured that out quite nicely, said Brom.
But what's the solution? I can't let him be killed.
Brom clasped his hands loosely.
The solution is quite obvious. Roran is going to have to learn how to defend himself. That may sound hard-hearted, but as you pointed out, you cannot risk meeting him. You may not remember this. You were half delirious at the time, but when we left Carvajal, I told you that I had left a warning letter for Roran, so he won't be totally unprepared for danger. If he has any sense at all, when the Razak show up in Carvajal again, he'll take my advice and flee.
I don't like this, said Eragon unhappily.
Ah, but you forget something.
What? He demanded.
There is some good in all of this. The king cannot afford a rider roaming around that he does not control. Galbatorix is the only known rider alive besides yourself. But he would like another one under his command. Before he tries to kill you or Roran, he will offer the chance to serve him. Unfortunately, if he ever gets close enough to make that proposition, it will be far too late for you to refuse and still live.
You call that some good?
It's all that's protecting Roran. As long as the king doesn't know which side you've chosen, he won't risk alienating you by harming your cousin. Keep that firmly in your mind. The Razak killed Garrow, but I think it was an ill-considered decision on their part. From what I know of Galbatorix, he would not have approved it unless he gained something from it.
And how will I be able to deny the king's wishes when he is threatening me with death? Asked Eragon sharply.
Brom sighed. He went to the nightstand and dipped his fingers in the basin of rosewater.
Galbatorix wants your willing cooperation. Without that, you are worse than useless to him. So the question becomes, if you are ever faced with this choice, are you willing to die for what you believe in? For that is the only way you will deny him.
The question hung in the air. Brom finally said,
It's a difficult question, and not one you can answer until you're faced with it. Keep in mind that many people have died for their beliefs. It's actually quite common. The real courage is living and suffering for what you believe in.